All right. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Welcome to the Head, Heart and Hands Climate Resilience Launch here at Charles Sturt University. Panelists are ready. And just a reminder, microphones on mute. There'll be questions later on. And there'll be backup information supplied. So if you want to follow this up, you have the opportunity to do so. I'd now like to introduce our convener, Rachel Shepherd.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the launch of our Head, Heart, Hands Climate Resilience Project. We are funded by the New South Wales Government Department of Industry and Environment and under the auspices of the Port Macquarie Community Garden, or as it's affectionately known and appropriately known, the Lost Plot. Now, Head, Heart and Hands is first and foremost a community project, and climate change is often perceived as divisive, but when you have a connected and resilient community, it doesn't matter what issue you have, you can find common ground. The ground we're gathering on and living our lives is verified country, and so I am very pleased to invite you to take a moment to acknowledge this land that we're living our lives on, led by Rhonda Radley and the Ngunnawal Nyurrin Women's Club.
I am Rhonda, I will know. This is my grandmother's country. He is my brother, one in one of Canada, one in one of Italy. He is my mother. Always was and always will be together with me. God, I am the Lord of God. Let us all die together as one. Amen.
In acknowledging Yirrkai Barai, I pay respect and honour Naya Barai, Mother Earth, the land, and all she holds. Landforms, waterways, creatures, all plants, ancestors, elders, all peoples, and you here today. I offer a blessing to cleanse and protect and bring the spirit.
Down to the
I'd now like to welcome Kate Woodley-Boy, who is the Director of External Engagement here at Charles Sturt University.
Thanks, Cameron.
And thank you, Aunty Rhonda, and the beautiful choir. Charles Sturt has been privileged to support the Fair Food Week for a number of years alongside the Macquarie Sustainability Network. And we are so excited to be collaborating with Rachel on the Head, Heart and Hands team to start this discussion tonight at their launch. Food is something that brings people together, and when we face such an immense challenge as climate change, it's so important to envision the future and start working together towards climate smart food production. And tonight seems a perfect way to bring the community together and start that discussion and work on solutions together. Charles Sturt University was the first university in 2016 to be named carbon neutral. We have an entire team that are committed to sustainability and bettering our community with our campuses we're in. So we are really excited to be a part of tonight and wish everyone the best as we work together to work to create a world worth living. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, Kate. All right, we'll look now a little bit more about Rachel Shepherd. Rachel is a local psychologist, she is a mum, and she is Head, Heart and Hands Climate Resilience team member. So she'll explain a little bit more about what the group do. Rachel.
So just to emphasise, everybody knows as well that this event is being recorded and I'll have the opportunity to share this with you friends later this year. So Head, Heart, Hands began with six women who met as a part of what Macquarie Hastings Sustainability Network, led by the commitment and energy to start with of Anna Durwood and a huge amount of input from Dr. Sarah Mollard, Jane Moy in particular, in order to secure the grant that was ultimately awarded in January 2020 this year. So the project involves a series of workshops, events, health and climate conference and online resources that are all about trying to connect our community more both with each other, resources and knowledge to be able to build our resilience to climate change impacts. The project is designed around four major themes, which are the built environment, health, individual and small business resilience to climate change, and food and land. So when we were thinking about how we would kick the project off, once we got the funding, we were thinking, okay, do we leave it? There's so much going on, do we leave it until next year? But as we, you know, in winter started to set our roots down a little bit, you know, we noticed how many people in our community were planting seeds for the first time throughout the time that COVID provided. And starting to experience those first tendrils coming up and seeing what that's like and having so much more value for what it means to have local food being grown for us and also a bit more of a value of how much work goes into producing food for us. And so we thought that spring was the perfect time to be planting the seeds of our project and starting to tap into the energy in our community around this issue. So why food and land? We want to focus on that theme with our launch. Look, food and land, food security and our food systems are certainly something that are impacted incredibly by climate change, but also it's something that everyone can come together around. That's some of our common ground that we have to walk together on. And it also lends itself really quickly to getting your hands dirty. Now, this event, this evening, is all about bringing some vision together of what our future food system could look like, but vision is nothing without action. So you might know a little bit about our YouTube channel and some of the other things we've got going, but this whole evening, while these wonderful women and men are talking about our vision for a future, we want you thinking, okay, what will I do this weekend? I hope you get some ideas and enjoy.
Alrighty, well thank you Rachel. Okay, well it's now time to meet our panel, and so let's kick things off with going from my right around to left. We have Rhiannon Reed-Rebellion-Simmons, long-term Macquarie Rector and Waste Reduction Warrior. Thank you for being here, Reed. You're an inspiration. I look forward to hearing more about what you've got to say. Ali Beer, who is Urban Permaculture Gardener, Community Garden Advocate. We also have Ali Meehan, Biripi traditional owner and Charles Sturt University lecturer. And also Rod and Desley Bailey, market gardeners from Masters of Fresh Homegrown Organics in the beautiful Rollins Plain. So a really interesting, diverse mix, you'd have to agree, of people that we hope that we can tap into their brains and share their collective knowledge. So thank you all for being here tonight. So let's kick things off with Rhiannon. Now, Rhi, you're passionate. You're also a young person, and you're really keen to see the next generation of young people grow up and learn about the environment and care for it like you have. So just tell us why you think being here tonight is important.
I think it's important to have youth representatives in any discussion that we're having about our climate future. I still do call myself in the youth bracket, probably not for much longer.
Same here. next week.
So I think that it's important to have representatives of all, as diverse as what this would be. For me, it's important that we are brought to any conversation about climate change, because we are the people that will be living in what will be this world in the next 20, 30, 50 years.
I love your earrings and your badge.
Thank you.
If you can't see it, the badge says Eat Local.
Dress to impress.
Our next panelist is Ali B. Ali. We've just had a chat before about your passion for growing food and sharing the food communities. Tell me a bit about yourself and why you think that's important.
Yeah, well, I was saying to you before, I think it's growing food for me connects me with everything that's good in life, really, or almost everything. So it gets me to slow down and stop and observe what's going on around me. It puts me in touch with the systems and processes that enable you to grow food. You have to kind of be aware of what's going on around you, and systems thinking is really something that we're all going to need to get a handle on going forward. And it enables me to eat great food, which is super, super fresh and super, super local. And I've noticed Kathy Egger did one of the little videos she did, food meters, and I think we should all be working towards food meters as much as we can. So not food miles, have it grow it right near you so you can pick it and eat it fresh. And it's just that added bonus of them being able to share any excess with people. And the community garden's a great example of that, where we come together, we garden, we share it out, and it's about so much more than hands in the dirt, although that for me is a fantastic place to be.
Now, Ali, you also, in our early discussion, talked about the importance of culture and country. So just tell us about that connection to country and why that is so important for all of us to learn about in terms of food and sustainability.
For me, the lens is about existence. And food is just, you know, one piece of the puzzle. So I remember back when I was young, I was doing my Year 12 certificate, I lived in a tent because I was homeless. But it defined for me what was home. And home for me was a feeling of connectedness and knowing, having that informed existence, knowing that I could just walk outside and grab food from the environment and country would provide for me. So when it was time to drop anchor with having family of my own, having kids, I thought, what a good idea to live in a tent, in a giant tent. And we spend the majority of our time outside, in the environment, and I don't know, it just feels a bit more connected for me to country and my culture as well.
And to our food growers, Rod and Desley Bailey. Now, you produce stunning produce and you sell it directly to the public. Just tell us about what drives you in your food production.
I believe that healthy, fresh, nutrient-dense food is a cornerstone of health and well-being. our food systems have been going at a gallop in the opposite direction of that for a long time. Developed very efficient industrialised food systems. I think it's time to regain some ground. You know, individuals and families are sacred, and I believe that we can't afford to cut corners for the next generation. And I think this is a real battle, you know, and I love seeing people growing their own food or buying local food. It's like a, it's good triumphing over evil in some way. There is so much good that comes into a community through becoming self-reliant to a large degree, as large as possible, by producing our own food. And, you know, the last 6 or 8 months have shown our vulnerability, if you like, to forces outside of our control. So everything that we can do to take personal responsibility as a community for our own needs can only be a positive thing.
Now, Desley, you're often the face, if you like, of the growing operation, and you also are a person that likes to, recycle and reuse a lot of what's grown so that nothing is wasted, value adding. Just take us through your philosophy.
Yeah, well, I think if you have food, you're so blessed. And to waste food is almost criminal, really, when there's so many that are lacking. And if it can't be eaten fresh, it can be eaten in some other way. And whether it's redone into a pesto or into a pie or into a smoothie or whatever it happens to be, a relish, and sold at another market, or if it's just given away to the neighbours or whatever, it's far better. Or, you know, there's always going to be something that goes to the compost, but even that is recycling and being reused. So, yeah, we just don't want to use our rubbish bins, really.
Exactly. Well, Ali, as you mentioned, your background is a passionate campaigner, activist, if you like,
climate change.
Sorry.
We're both good looking young girls.
You see the confusion. That's true. Sorry. I have my number of guests here, and they're all asked about. So constantly.
We're not sitting in our
desk again. I wasn't even following my own numbering system. So after this session, there'll be a session on how to run a Zoom session for the panel, and I'll be convening that. Right, sorry for that interruption. I've got the old plates on. Again, being a young person, being passionate about the environment and food, I mean, let's talk about things that I can actually do, the practical examples. So what kinds of things do you find yourself trying to do that either the way you source what you eat or how you contribute to try and make the environment a better one?
Cool. I grow the small things that I can grow, salad greens, herbs, those kinds of things on a little balcony I rent, so I don't have the access to a large plot of land to grow my own food. But I also contribute to people like Desley, who we love, and we purchase food grown in this area. That's something that I'm very passionate about. I think that contributing to a local food system is important for anyone to do, whether it's growing your own food, whether you're a part of a community garden, whether you're supporting a local farmer in whatever capacity that is. For me, I'm huge on waste. I'm often referred to as a waste educator. I spend a lot of my time teaching other people how to not put food in the bin. We waste tons of food every year. I wrote it down today. 7.3 million tons of food goes to waste every year in Australia.
Which is 13,000 Olympic spoonfuls for just, anyone who wants to
know. Oh, I love that
you
know that.
That's a lot.
You know, it's a lot. It costs the $20 billion. It costs taxpayers every year to dispose of our own food, which doesn't make a lot of sense to me. It's a lot of money that could definitely go to a plethora of other climate issues. So participating in a local food system is easy, it's accessible. We have the privilege of living in a place that has fertile soil. We have the privilege of having farmers so close to us that we can access at any time. And they've all made it so easy because we can order online now, and it's too tempting sometimes. But it is fantastic. I spend all of my excess hours making videos on how to not waste food. So I pickle a lot, I dehydrate, I roast, I freeze. Yeah, we don't reduce constantly.
Well, that's your mantra, Ali. You're the queen of the recycle and reuse. To me, it makes perfect sense what we're talking about. But why don't we do it? What's stopping us?
Yeah, that's a big question. I think I didn't know it off the top of my head. I was looking it up today too, because I think it's a really scary number. $20 billion a year. And that is just indicative of a broken system. Like, there's something wrong with that. That we are, if anyone who grows any food knows that it's not easy to grow, to get something from a seed to something you can eat. It takes love and care and inputs, and for that to then end up not being used. And a lot of that happens kind of at the, these are Australian figures, by the way, it's not worldwide, that's just Australia. So a lot of it happens, you know, there are multiple places along the way that it happens, but I think the starting point is recognising that the system, and it goes to what Rod was saying, we're kind of struggling against a duopoly almost of food system, food that's highly processed and not very good for us. And if we can take back control and support our local farmers and grow locally, and then we're much more secure, because I think this last year has given us all a shock that we've got 3 days worth of food sitting on the supermarket shelves, and that 3 days goes pretty quickly when the highways cut.
There's panic, and that's only 3 days if someone doesn't go in and buy everything.
That's right!
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So the food system that we live in, you know, is driven by consumer demand. I mean, if we didn't want it would disappear, wouldn't it? So how do we change the mindset that says, you know, what are the hurdles? I mean, we love convenience, and we tend to buy on price a lot of the time, which influences probably bad choices. So how do we change that mindset and say, I'm happy to spend a little bit more, I'm happy to go a little bit out of my way, just little things. How do we get overall consumers to think like that?
We don't waste it with crisis.
Yeah.
You know, the number of customers looking for local food increased quite dramatically, you know, 5 or 6 months ago. And I hope enough of those have tasted and seen that local is better and are going to stick with it. But now's the time to run events like this and to continue that education. You know, we just need to educate, encourage, inspire, you know, give people opportunities. That's what we need.
So what were people doing, and what were they saying to you in reference when the COVID crisis is on and suddenly you've got these new customers turning up? What was it in their mind? What were they sharing with you?
Oh, many of the new ones didn't share. You know, a lot of the new ones were kind of, we spend a lot of time talking at the market. But a lot of the new ones are there just to buy their produce and move out. Some didn't know, you know, some didn't know that this was available. The Port Macquarie Food Hub was a great thing that sprung up out of this necessity with farmers that the majority of their revenue came from selling to restaurant cafes. And then all of a sudden, restaurant cafes are closed down and they've got all this produce. And where are they going to move it? So they developed this Port Macquarie Food Hub, which is a fantastic way for those people, especially the wanting to stay home. They weren't really sharing, but I can only assume it was we need to know where our food comes from. Where is our local food? If the shops run out, where can I find food?
Yeah, so what happens if the world comes to an end, so to speak, and we're in this bubble? We're all used to the word bubble now. So we're in a mid-north coast bubble where you can only consume what you've grown. I mean, as a community, could we survive? Is there enough grown here and enough resources for us to be self-sufficient?
So how many millions of tons were wasted?
Oh, 7.3 million tons.
Okay, so that
there's enough.
Our part of that is quite a few thousand tons. Yeah, so we just need to get better at using what we've got. You know, there's a lot of fantastic farmers in our region that are growing all sorts of things. And if the demand grows for local food, the farmers will respond.
Well, you mentioned, I've heard the word system mentioned a few times now, that we're in a food system which has things, inputs and outputs and resources that get recycled. So what would a perfect food system look like? Rhianna, what do you think? What does it look like, a food system?
So I've been given the magic wand and all farms in this area for me would be regenerative farms. So they sequester carbon from the atmosphere, they store it in the soil, it's then fed to plants and the cycle continues. Regenerative farming is something that isn't new, it's a pretty well-known system, but it's not something that we teach farmers. They have to teach it themselves. They have to figure out this system on their own. For me, it would be having our community members support farmers that did this regenerative? I'm sorry, that was good. This type of farming, which is so important to this area that we live in. We're surrounded by water, we're surrounded by oceans and rivers, and they don't need any more chemicals or topsoils, anything being leached into this water. If more people in this community access the amazing farmers that we had around, I think it would see quite a large boom in how many people would start small regenerative farms. And I think, it starts with us. You as a consumer hold all that power. It's not hard, it's not expensive, it's something that we can all access quite easily.
Ali, what can we fix? What's the perfect food system like?
I don't know that there is a perfect one, but what I would like to think about, I suppose, is what can everyone out there and all around us, what can you imagine? Because if you can imagine it, you can create it. But at the moment, we're lacking in imagination. So we've got supermarkets which sell primarily overproduced, very processed food, which is not good for us, but it's addictive because it's got lots of sugar and corn syrup in it. If, just imagine, go on a little journey with me. So imagine we don't have any supermarkets in Port Macquarie. So what would there be instead? Maybe there would be lots of Masters of Fresh.
And undercover market space.
Lots of undercover, like a permanent co-op. Permanent food co-op in Port Macquarie, which is sort of where the food hub's heading, but bigger and open all the time. And then if for those things that we can't grow here, like sugar and coffee and tea, although somebody really needs to start a tea farm because I'm a bit of an addict. So we buy those in a collective wholesale kind of way. So there are people on the Zoom who I'm in a food co-op with, and we buy bulk products so that we reduce our packaging. We might buy 20 kilos of macadamia nuts, lucky us. And or something like that. We buy it in bulk, we divvy it up, we have one package instead of 65.
One so, food mile.
Yeah, exactly. So it's just, you've got to start imagining your own little piece of it, and then out of that grows a system. I don't think we can just kind of go, this is where we're going to land, because it's going to evolve.
Yeah, we need to make that step gradually and constructively.
and know that we can all do it. Like, if we all do our little imperfect piece, it's going to add up to a whole lot.
I think that's the key, that it starts with every individual, every house, every home, every family. So everybody has something, even if it was pots on their veranda, or if they've got a little patch out the back that's growing something, that would be enough to swap for something else when you've got surplus cucumbers and you swap it for a cabbage or whatever it wants to be. That's a huge step.
And I think that's all well and good, but the reality is that as consumers, we have to make sacrifices. Like, you can't get avocados all year round. Yes. And I think it's romanticising and sensationalising to think that, like, you know, you won't have to make sacrifices. I mean, let alone makes a great tea.
Yes.
If we can make those sacrifices, there are other options, and it's just, you know, trying new things and eating local produce and getting a taste for what local produce is. Like,
I think that's part of the educational eating.
To learn to eat what's in season. Like, I mean, we have so much veg on our farm. If we don't grow cucumbers, we don't eat cucumbers. Yeah. You know, there's plenty of else to eat. We don't need a cucumber in our salad. In fact, salad in our house has become salad mixed with dressing because there's so much salad.
Cameron, you're talking about future food system. Okay. We can't afford to talk about the future without talking about our children. And so if I was to add something with my magic wand, it would be ways to engage in our next two or three generations. So,
inspire.
Yeah, to inspire them. That means that our young people need to see success. So I have the privilege of having three families, three mums bring their kids into our garden most weeks for a couple of hours at a time. The young people getting, you know, everything, children from the age of 4 to 16 or 17 come into the garden. And they get involved in all aspects of what we're doing on the market garden, and they get to take home a box of veggies, take as many veggies home for their family for the week in return for their labour. You know, their labour is worthy of their hire, and we pay them in food. And I'd just like to see... It's got to start with families. You know, we can't rely on the schools, although it would be fantastic to have some serious curriculum happening and opportunities for young people, etc. You know, what better than taking a group of primary school kids to the community garden every week? Or, you know what I'm talking about, finding opportunities for young people to see success, you know.
Because it's also about changing the value system, isn't it?
Exactly.
As they learn to value, they learn how food's grown and how to value it, that starts changing everything.
Yeah. Yes. See, yeah. It's not long since we were largely a rural population, you know? We're now more urban than we are rural. But if we go back a generation, nearly all of us were growing food in our backyard, or, you know, plot out the back if we were dairy farmers or whatever. But we seem to be skipped a generation or two, and it's time to regain that ground and re-inspire our young people to with the joy of what you're talking about before, of getting in the dirt and learning how nature works and how we can be stewards of this natural environment we've been blessed with, and reap the rewards, take them home, and prepare a meal, share it with others. I mean, that's just so inspiring.
It is.
You know? And if our young people can just get a hold of that and it becomes our culture again, where we're growing food in the backyard if we live in town. You know, if that can become, we can all grow our herbs, can't we, Rick?
So easy.
We can all grow tomatoes in pots, you know, or a few Lebo cucumbers or whatever you like, you know.
And also I think, and you're best to talk to this, Ali, but just the learning what is growing in our environment already around us, so we don't necessarily have to grow ourselves. There's food in abundance. We just need to know where to look and what it is. And you know, maybe we don't all need to grow. Some people are never going to be interested in that, but if we all value it appropriately, then that's the change. So it's really...
Ali, I'm just at, I mean, this is beautiful, our country. For thousands of years, Aboriginal people lived here. they farmed the land the way that they did. They used the resources. They respected the country. So I'm just curious, from the cultural perspective that you have, you know, what you see we need to sort of go to try and either appreciate more the Indigenous culture here and embrace that more in what we're doing.
Yeah, and I think it goes in with that, you know, deep ecology. And we talked about seasonal foods. Well, the lens that I grew up with is country provides. And when that particular plant or animal's in season, it's going to be fat, it's going to be ripe, it's going to be juicy. And the country's going to go, here I am! And you're going to, you know, gather that. So with our citrus fruits, you know, they're turning on when we need those. This country's saying, okay, it's coming into the cooler time. This is the citrus. You get your vitamin C up. So I think it's that deep ecology and just knowing, like, the more that you can learn that's flowering, this, that means I've got to go and collect this very soon. And being part of that, very observant of that conversation, it's a bit less work for us. And I think that's a birthright as humans, is to be able to live in an environment where it's providing for you because it wants to sustain you. And you have that relationship. It's not just, I'm taking because I need to survive. It's like, I give to you, you give to me, yada yada.
And where did you learn these ideals? Were they passed down to you from family members and elders?
Yeah, and it's just, you know, growing up and listening to the aunties, and it's not necessarily, this is what I'm going to teach you, it's that being and that deep knowing of, you know, walking the beach with my aunties when I was young and looking for pig face and going picky in. So I think it's learned as part of the existence.
Well, we were talking earlier about the fact that actually growing food can transform your life. It can actually have so many benefits. And Rod, you were saying to me that you came from a high-pressured corporate existence, and you tossed that in to farm. And when I'm hearing you speaking, it's almost with that sort of passion that you've, you know, discovered a new world. I mean, how... I'm feeding off that because I think it's great. You just tell me the restorative benefits of, and I'm looking at your hands as well. They're soiled, they're cracked, they've got
hard
from
playing
from your hands. But that's what it's all about. How is growing and being in the food growing business, how has that changed your life?
Discovering the new world, that was interesting. it was actually, I spent a lot of years spending a lot of time around people, and you know, that can be really draining. And I guess what I actually did was go back to what I was resisting for a long time. My parents would always have a garden, always have growing food wherever we were, and I just used to hate working in the veggie garden.
You know, because you had
to. Well, to their credit, they didn't make me, but...
That's different.
We went through a period where we were really struggling financially, and I can remember in grade 9 in high school, starting at a brand new school, okay, a country high school in Western Australia, and in my lunchbox were 2 apple cucumbers, 2 tomatoes, and 2 cobs of corn. That was in my lunchbox. That was it, you know, and I felt really weird. And some of the other kids felt really weird too, because I didn't have cheese and pickle sandwiches or bacon and cheese or whatever, okay? But it was out of necessity for us. My dad had left a corporate career, and he's actually working at a timber mill trying to pay off just really struggling. So it was a matter of necessity. But when I finally came to my senses, I guess, and realised we've got this family veggie garden here, let's do this full time. Let's see where this can go. It really was a change for me.
And that was 5 years ago that you which you started
about 5 years ago.
And you have roughly one acre of ground, and in that 1 acre, how many varieties of plants and food are you growing?
Depends what time of year, but 20 to 35 sort of thing, yeah.
And you generate a turnover of something like $300,000 just from that bit of ground.
That's what we're aiming for this year, yeah.
That's amazing.
It is amazing. It's also amazing how small profit margins are.
You don't have home
You know, we're talking about value before.
Yeah.
You know, and anyone that wants to get rich knows not to go into farming, okay? And we can have a whole hours conversation around
that's
that.
That's the next Zoom session.
Okay, but for me, you know, you started off asking me this question, how's it changed me? You know, I can really relate to living in a tent, because at the same time we were gardening and taking corn in my lunchbox, my mum and dad and I lived in a tent. Okay, and then, anyway, won't go there, but there are so many both tangible and intangible benefits of living and working in nature. You know, to work in the soil and to start to see the secrets of what's going on there is just incredible. I mean, if I had my time over again, I'd really struggle to decide whether I was going to be an entomologist or a microbiologist, soil biologist, you know. They're just so exciting, both insects and soil. But, you know, to be in the sun all day, or in the rain, or in the frost, or whatever it is just so invigorating. And sometimes I've got to go and sit in the shed in January when it's just so humid I can't stand it. But the health benefits, both physical and mental health benefits I've received have been fantastic. You know, I just get so much out of doing it. But there's more to it even than that. You know, Desley will say, she comes home on Tuesday night from market and she's tired, she's spent, she's had it, and the last thing she wants to do is answer all my questions. I'm asking her about all our fantastic customers. How's this one going? How's that one going? What's happening with this one coming? Because community is the other thing. I'm an arm length from the community of our fantastic customers, so I'll try to live it vicariously through Desley. But I just love that sense of community, that we are somehow positively contributing to families on the mid-north coast. And if me growing some healthy, nutrient-dense food somehow helps that family reach their potential, or one of those children have a health outcome they might not have had otherwise, man, my life is worth living.
Yes.
Exactly. Well, we've solved the problems of the world now, thank goodness. Regenerative farming, you mentioned that. I've never heard of it, the term before. So I'm just sort of curious, is regenerative farming something that you guys are all familiar with and practice? And if so, just describe what it is to you.
We don't just take from the land. You give back. You don't let anything be depleted from the land.
I can give an example.
Yeah.
We always teach our kids that you've got to spit out the seeds on country. So when you're eating something, you spit the seeds out to give back. And often we use this when we're walking along particular trails, so we know next year we follow that plan to stick to the same trail. So we give back through seed dispersal.
Right.
So there's a fantastic movement, and there's actually a regenerative agriculture field of study now starting up at Lismore campus, Southern Cross, yeah, and it's kind of become much more talked about since Charles Massey wrote his book called The Real Green Warbler, which I highly recommend anyone read if you get a chance. It's a fabulous book, and it's about looking at making the land better and more diverse and regenerated rather than depleted, and it's a right high up on the list of carbon drawdown actions that we can take. So Charlie sort of says agriculture has been part of the cause and the problem with creating climate change, and it can also be a really big part of the solution. So it's about stocking levels and high rotation and long rest times for paddocks, and it's not rocket science, but when you look at a farm that's been farmed that way next to their neighbours who haven't been farmed that way in a drought, man, you can really tell the difference.
Yeah.
Like, there's still ground cover, which means that water is still getting absorbed. Any water that does come, rather than running off and creating, you know, you're not getting all the dust. I could go on forever. It's a bit of a passion.
That's what this is all about.
I got to visit a regenerative farm recently, and they've only just taken over this space, and they've been giving back, rotating the animals that they have on the land. And the farmer that I was with, we pulled out love this because there was mycelium in the soil, and we were both just going nuts about how exciting it was that this soil, where all of the topsoil had been taken and it was the hard clay base, had finally got something happening back in there. And I think it's such a privilege to take a piece of land and slowly give back so that we get to continue to use it and take from it.
Yeah, giving back and regenerating the land for future generations. I am fascinated to, you know, this discussion about restoring the land. Now, I guess my understanding is, when I speak to farmers, when you ask about these issues, they go, well, of course, I have to look after the land. That's my livelihood. If I ruin the land, then there goes my business and it's out the window. But I guess it's different shades of that discussion. Exactly what is looking after the land? Is it looking after it so I'll make a buck, or is it looking after it so that I'll actually be able to give something back to the next person or the next, or the community in general? How important is it for you, for example, to make sure that your property is sustainable in the long run, so that, who knows, maybe your children will take over, for future generations?
I think we need to take the long-term view. It's the only sane approach to take. So, when I get visited every morning by the blue wrens and the finches and Jackie Winter and the magpies and, all the other birds that come in, that's one layer. But down underneath the soil, in regen ag, it's all about the soil, but it's not actually. It's about the critters that live in the soil. The other things that turn, in as little as 2 weeks, you can turn around what's happening in the soil, going from a soil that's going to hell in a handbasket to something that's on its way to life and vitality. We just need to recognise that wherever we grow, whatever environment we've been blessed with, that we are required, morally, spiritually, every way you look at it, to be stewards. And it's not just so that we get a better bottom line, and it's not just so our children can have something to inherit or the next generations. It's because as human beings, we are in a position to be stewards of nature, this amazing thing that we are surrounded by.
And part of. Yeah, and we are actually part of it.
Yeah, exactly. So, a lot of fellow farmers, we talked about how the food industry or the food system is consumer driven, right? And a lot of our farmers in Australia and all throughout the world are on a treadmill, okay? And we've put them on it, okay? Because as you mentioned before, we want value for money. We care less about nutrient density or the healthfulness of our food than we do about how much it costs us.
We also don't want the tomato with the bark on. I was going to say, the look of it.
Yeah, and so,
can carry it.
So this puts incredible pressures on farmers, okay, to produce fantastic looking products, okay, free. What percentage does the farmer actually get for the food you buy in the supermarkets?
This is something I wanted to bring up, Rod, because I think it's good to remember that this is Fair Food Week, And one, I mean, fair food is a massive topic, but one of the things is going back to that value. We don't value the food, and so therefore we don't pay the farmers what it's yeah. worth and what.
We get disconnected from that farm system, though, is that we don't actually realise how much work, effort, resources yeah. goes into producing that thing.
So the fair food system is one that is good food at a fair price that provides living wage for the farmer and his team, okay, which then allows that business, that family farming business, to be sustainable. And so farmers have a part to play in this, as do consumers. We need to work together to make sure that we've got something fantastic going forward.
I think the principle, though, the regenerative,
yeah.
is the same principle that we try and teach, I've been trying to teach my children. If you borrow something, return it in a better condition than what you
yes.
received it. And that's
yeah.
what we're trying to do. When we moved onto our land, our block, our property, whatever that was, the soil wasn't great.
Yeah.
It was, yeah, because it had been used for conventional farming. And so we are making in our efforts to make it better than what it was when we got it. I think that's what we can do. Every one of us, no matter whatever it is in our small sphere, we can return it in a better condition.
Well, folks, we're going to have a small break now because just to allow you to freshen up, so to speak, grab a water. And then after that, we're going to go to you, the audience, to get some listener questions and provide some sort of feedback in reference to those, and then also still to come, we'll tell you how you can access further information about the panel and the discussion, so that if we've sparked some ideas from today, you can go away and continue learning and continue to feel the passion, so to speak. So back in 5 minutes.
A part of our launch is that we're also convening a YouTube channel, which is showcasing actions of locals across the mid-north coast, and it's perfectly imperfect. We've invited people to make these submissions that are perfectly imperfect, put them on our YouTube channel, which I think we've got up in the chat as well. But as a part of that, we decided to sweeten the deal, which worked quite well because I think we've got 15 submissions already. But we decided that we put people into a raffle and announced two winners tonight. And having drawn them out, we'll show you the two videos that have won their prize. I'm coming back.
Oh, that's an awful crap.
The copy of the much sought after Milkwood and Retro Suburbia, part of many people's book collections who are in this area and you might find helpful. And so, why don't we go straight to the videos and you can see some of what's been happening on our YouTube channel.
So, what we're having today is a general palette, which we've repurposed from the providers of the Lane Farm, the new house. And you can pop that up. And that size, an unbelievable fire, so that makes it simple. And cut it down, and start step straight up like this. And start nailing it together, and then start grounding the boxes like this. And then eventually when you have enough of those, you have something that looks good like this. A bit closer. This is an LVI, which has been created from all recycled materials. There's a top here, there's a middle, and then there's the base. So effectively, with these leaving the bottom two thirds, coming through the entry at the front, which you can see. And lately, we've had these beehives for 5 years now. So we got our first hive 5 years ago. We split that to make two hives. We split that the following year to make four hives. So effectively, every year, you can do a split if the hive's healthy. And the benefits of doing the splits is we get more netted bees, into the local community, and we get a lot more people interested in having our bees. So a lot of our friends are hosting these hives. We've got about 10 or so hives at the moment with friends, and some more. And yeah, it's a good thing to do using the special materials, and the bees can fly about 500 metres. So they've got their own little ecosystem that works well in the setting, because there's plenty of flowers around, and they're around the gardens. So it's a healthy environment for everyone, and it's a good awareness for people to understand a little bit more about bees. So you can harvest the hives for honey. We choose not to, just because it's a very small amount of honey from a hive. Our preference is to keep splitting eggs and creating more hives so that there's more bees around. The honey is very good for you, but it just creates only a small amount from the hives. So that's our bee story.
And they pollinate all the veggie patches, because without bees, we have no food.
That's right, yeah, they've got little pollinators, so we need to survive.
That's James, and I'm from Port Macquarie. I come down to this local barbecue here. It's put on by some people. An old fella's been doing it for quite a while now. And he feeds people who are, I suppose you could just use a feed. That's pretty much the criteria. If you could use a feed, you can come down and you can sit and have a feed. You can help out, you can contribute or not. And anyway, today's been a quiet one. But I thought I'd do something different today, because I snagged some potatoes from the community garden, the Lost Flood. So I boiled up these potatoes, I washed them and scrubbed them. Then I like to kind of cool them down a bit. And I cooked them up with some garlic, parsley, cracked pepper, mayonnaise of course. I put in some chilli, some lemon myrtle. And then my secret ingredient, aside from the lemon myrtle, is sauerkraut, which I am absolutely addicted to. And I thought it would go pretty well with this the community barbecue down here, which happens a couple of times a week. Usually it's your pretty standard stuff. It's sausages, eggs, mushrooms, onions on bread. And I wasn't sure how people were going to receive a potato salad, especially one with strange ingredients like sauerkraut, but it turns out that despite my concerns, the potato salad sourced from, well, made from potatoes from the Lost Flood, was wolfed down in about one sitting by even the small crowd here we have today, the skeleton crew. This is about as small as it gets, sometimes it's up to 15, 20 or so people. So yeah, unfortunately I don't have any footage of the potato salad being enjoyed because it's all been eaten. But I think it's a really good example of how foodstuffs, I mean half the ingredients that I sourced were pretty local, aside from the mayonnaise of course. The lemon myrtle was given to me, or it was recycled, it was rescued. Potatoes obviously grown locally, and then shared with locals here who can use it. And I think the interesting thing about this is that this model can be scaled up to the whole population. You know, everyone's got some herbs in the back of the cupboard, and everyone's got some space to grow potatoes. And I suppose everyone knows someone who could use a feed. You know, so I suppose it's just about reaching out and being there for people who could use a bit of support. And everyone gets to have a nice barbecue at the end of the day.
So you can see, even just from that small selection, we've got a pretty diverse set of ideas coming up on our YouTube channel. And I'll also let you know, we've got a playlist that's dedicated to a good portion of video for each of our panellists as well, showcasing what they're actually doing, so you can see what they're doing and get to talk about it in a bit more depth as well. I also want to give a special shout out to Troy Roberts from Marimpa Permaculture, who's put together a great video for us, and we're still putting on his food forest version for the food, for the YouTube channel as well. And also Cardia Forsyth from out at Grow Sustainable Livings out at
Tom's Creek, where they're doing farm tours and all sorts of things, but they're doing regenerative farming with goats and using goats to eradicate noxious weeds like wild tobacco. And that's one of the videos that's up there, really, really cool one to have a look at. And I should name as well, sorry, our winners were Jason Doyle and James McCullum. So congratulations, and we'll be in touch with your story. I suppose now we'll be going to some questions.
Yes, well, we have some listener questions here. Did you want to read those out, or?
We do actually have some new ones from the audience as well.
Oh, okay.
What would you?
I'm all ears.
We'll do a bit of both. Okay. So we've invited a few questions and comments from people in the community. One of them was in regards to what we already talked about, was the Port Macquarie Food Hub. So Port Macquarie Food Hub was an initiative that started during COVID to bring together regional produce in the mid-north coast to be easily accessed. We asked Andrew Hearn, who started the Food Hub, to comment on how locals can best support our local growers. And this is what he had to say. We had a wave of support as we began. However, as the world is returning to the new normal, the support is waning from locals. It's tough because farmers aren't just producing local food. They're preserving waterways, improving our soil, growing local food security, and creating the highest nutritional value you can get. Yes, our products cost more, and it's less convenient than dropping by Coldsworth, but you're paying for the preserving of our environment, keeping chemicals off our farmers' hands and out of our food, protecting our waterways, and supporting our local economy. So Andrew's question to the panel is, how do we help community really understand in their guts the value of locally produced food, then translate that to being willing to pay more for that value and work around inconvenience? How do we help community understand the value and translate that into willingness to pay more and work around the inconvenience?
So my view on that is we need to make it convenient. We're never going to compete with the Coldsworth unless we've got something of a similar model where somebody goes, oh, whoops, I forgot the spuds. I'll trot down to the co-op and get some spuds. So the food hub's awesome, but it's not open all the time and the produce isn't there all the time. And I think that, you know, you're always going to reach a certain percentage of the population who are willing to go that extra. But if you're talking about big change across the whole suite of the population, it's got to be convenient.
For me, I think it comes back to education, and we keep talking about educating people and why that's important. But again, on food waste, because it's so convenient, it's so easy for us to throw away food. If we invested and paid more for the produce that was grown near us, and we had something that we had just spent money on, we're less likely to waste it, which means that you're going to get more meals out of less produce. You learn how to utilize everything from top to tail. You use everything instead of just tossing it away, the leftovers and those kinds of things as well. So I think educating people on how to make food top to tail is important as well.
I don't think there's an off-the-shelf answer. I think this is a good problem that we're all trying to navigate through. And when does a movement stop becoming a movement? When does it become a norm, a cultural norm for us as a community? So I think, you know, there's many pieces of the puzzle, but I think this mob might have more of an answer to that.
It's the one we stay awake thinking about.
I think Bree's right. I think there's a lot of education to be done. And I think Al is also right that we need to, until we can change that culture and, I guess, change the values, we need to make it as convenient as possible. And we need to make it a positive experience. And they, you know, someone who eats our carrot, who then goes and buys one from Coldsworth, whatever you want to call it, should go, ew, I'm not going to buy one of those carrots again. There should be enough in the local produce for
for a discerning person to want to go back. But it does need the convenience and it does need the education. And it also needs us to be smart about meeting the pain points of our customers. You know, what are customers looking for? Do we need to educate them on how to eat seasonally? Do I need to make up menu plans and recipes that go with my emails or with my everything else, which is actually something that I plan on doing. If I had some time, I would do that. But I plan on making time one day. I'll sell it if I can manage it. But yeah, I think that all of those things are important.
Yeah. And I think also, sorry, part of the not everyone is always going to have capacity to pay that extra. We have a lot of people who are on low incomes, and there is still stuff they can do to support our local food security, and it really comes back to not wasting food, saving themselves $4,000 a year, because that's what the average family wastes in Australia on throwing food out. So they buy five bags of groceries, one you put straight in the bin, because that's what ends up happening to it. So it's not, I mean, Andrew's question's great, but I think there are lots of little pieces to the puzzle that go to helping make us more secure.
I've got a suggestion for the people on the budget. Come to our farm.
Yes.
Cultivate, and we will give you vegetables.
Yes.
Can I add something else as well? We eat, why do we eat? Not just for pleasure, but for health. Eating should be pleasurable. I think the further we go down reclaiming agriculture, you know, we've thrown this term regenerative around, organic, or however you want to put it, where the farmers are being paid a fair price for producing nutritious food, the further we go down that pathway, the more authentic our conversation can become about food as medicine. Do you know what I mean? That food's just not something you do to get calories, but food is something you do to preserve health if you've got it, and return health if you've lost it.
So Ali's talking about that in nature it always pops up. The things that we need seasonally are always there ready for us to
consume. But in our system, the systems of growing that we're industrialised farming, if you like, big ag or however you want to put it, we've lost that. You know, and you know, if you talk to a grain farmer that produces wheat or barley or whatever with a higher protein content gets paid more money. That makes sense, doesn't it? But who's analysing kale? Or broccoli? And it's famous.
And so I'm mindful we are wrapping up.
Okay, sorry.
Well, no, but was there kind of a final element?
Yeah, once again, it's coming back to the value. People, it's not just paying extra money to buy local food. It should be paying extra money to buy better health for my family. And that's what we should be getting out of our local food. That's what people deserve, and that's what we should be giving them.
Okay. And so that was in response to Andrew. Big one. So I think we've only got time. Oh, I think we've only got time for one more question before we head towards things. And you know, maybe we're talking about needing another question and answer session at some point. So one of the questions that we've had come in from the audience is that growing the food feels so personal when you put so much effort in. What are your tips for new gardeners to stay motivated when an army of crickets decimate your Brussels sprouts?
Oh, asking for a friend.
Oh God, I don't know. You're gonna fail heaps of times when you're growing food. It's gonna be really sad.
You come to the last spot.
Come to the last spot. You do want to secretly kill all the crickets, but we do need them. So
get a guinea fowl.
Yeah, there you go. Get a chicken.
This is how it happens.
I think one of the keys is to find someone to be a mentor. You know, if you live in town,
Lost spot.
Maybe even there's someone closer. Walk around your neighbourhood and find someone that's got a fantastic garden and go and say, hey, your garden's fantastic. You know, I'm just a beginner. What do I do about crickets? Builds community as well as your own ability to grow food. You know, and then we've got the lost plot here. Talk to people. Find out. Look for solutions. Educate yourself with this. But, yeah, be ready to share.
Eat crickets.
Brussels sprout plated crickets.
So maybe I'll ask one more question. What are the best ideas to get kids to learn how nature works?
Get them in.
You've got 30 seconds.
Be in it and learn together. If you don't know it, if you don't know as the parent, then explore together. It's even better for children if you're not the one just telling them everything, but you're actually learning together, then it's new for both of you. But you've got to be in it, and you've got to love it, and you've got to have a passion for it.
Choose the child's favourite food, grow it in the backyard, yeah. Let them harvest it, prepare it, eat it, share it. Yeah, so inspiring.
And teach them the signs that nature tells you. Like I did one of my emails recently. It was about Jackie Winter. When Jackie Winter sings, winter's on its way out, spring's on its way in, prepare. Winter tells us that. I mean, nature tells us things. Learn to read it.
And go to the lost spot as well. Full of, I mean, sorry to sound like a broken record, but full of mums and dads and kids and interacting with other kids who are into garden.
Is
a way to inspire.
Success breeds success.
So we've actually had a lot more questions come through, and I'll talk about that more when we wrap up.
All right. Well, look, I think we're coming to the business end of things. Let us just spend a minute or thereabouts, just your thoughts, your takeaways from tonight, a final maybe imparted message on how you think tonight has gone, and we might just start with you, Rhianna, just your thoughts on tonight.
This tonight has very much filled my cup. Being around other passionate people makes it so much easier to do the things that you're passionate about. So the more that you participate in this kind of culture, you're sitting at home going, this is really hard for me, I'm alone, I'm the only person that wants to do this. You're not, we're all here for it, and we are all more than willing to share the knowledge that we have. And then when you become part of that community, you tend to do more. I think that's so important.
Ellie?
Oh, so much more to say, but I want to... I guess I want to leave you with a little vision that I have for the future, and I'd have to pick one of many. But so how about imagine if instead of lawns, our urban gardens were filled with locally native plants and or food plants. The people that before that happened used to mow the lawns are now paid to learn to become permaculture stewards or garden stewards, and they look after those. And at the bottom of it all, council runs a nursery that is a social enterprise employing people who need jobs, and they actually provide incentives for all those gardeners to plant those plants. So we get rid of lawns, we get rid of mowers, and leaf blowers, which are a nightmare if you live in the urban environment. We're growing food, we're growing biodiversity, because without biodiversity and native animals and bees and everything, you're not going to have food diversity or food security. And we could be doing something socially so amazing as well, and growing community. So,
that's forward to then.
Yeah. My sort of in the same stream is to know your social capital and go with that, because it's a really good model. We can't be great at everything. We can't be the bee person. We can't be the mushroom person. We can't be the veggie market. We can't be the... You know, map out who is good at what, who's good at being your mentor when your Brussels sprouts go to shit. You know, map out who's going to teach your kids to engage with the environment if that relationship doesn't work well. You know, my aunties taught me, not my parents. So look at your social capital network and map out that value in knowing who you know and what they know.
I think there's probably a lot of people who would love to grow something but feel like they don't have a green thumb, or they've tried and it's failed, or they just don't know where to start. I think the most important thing is just to give it a go. Sometimes we just need to put those seeds in, know that we're going to have some failures, know that that's okay. Ali was saying, find someone to get some advice from. But just do it. Sometimes it's the mental barrier that we have to get past. Once we can get past the mental barrier and we just do it, it's actually not that bad. It's like a relationship. Growing food is like a relationship. It needs little attentions often. And if you can give it that and just be intentional and aware, it'll happen for you.
And Rod, one thread I think that's come through our discussion tonight is the fact that we need to take personal responsibility. If we're talking about community food resilience and security, then each of us has a role to play in that. We can't, it's wonderful when council acts in an enlightened way, or, you know, government put in place policies that are enlightened, but we can't rely on them. We've just got to make decisions within our own sphere, as individuals, as family members, as parents, and as community members. We've got to take responsibility. Yeah, just face the facts. We need to do our little part to take responsibility of our own food needs where we can, and act responsibly as a community to make sure that everyone's doing okay. We've all got plenty of good, healthy, fresh, local, nutritious food to eat.
Well, thanks to each and every one of you for being a part of the panel discussion itself. It's certainly been great to sort of learn more and to tap into that passion of the food system, growing our own food in a sustainable way. I'd now like to go back to our convener, Rachel Shepherd, just to close out the session.
Thank you everyone for joining us, and we've got lots of thank yous, and the biggest one of course is to our wonderful panellists, and we'll be showing them a token of our appreciation from LV's and Drury Lane, which are two restaurants locally that really focus on local produce and supporting local producers, and in fact LV's grow some of their own. We also need to thank Cameron for his skillful facilitation this evening, and bringing out some of the passion of our panellists. A big thank you to CSU for facilitating the space for us, to Kate Woodboy, and to Eric, who you haven't seen, but has made everything work. We love Eric. And a big thank you also to Linda Schlenker, who, if you go and see the YouTube channel, virtually everything that's up there that wasn't filmed by locals is there because of her. And she did the videos for our panellists here as well, that you'll see. So I think it's really clear that there's a lot of discussion still to be had. So if you want to continue this discussion, we might need to think about more options to make it a bit more comprehensive. But please do follow us on our Head, Heart and Hands Port Macquarie Facebook page, Instagram and Twitter. And what you'll see is some opportunities to keep on engaging over the next, not only over the weekend, but actually into the future. So that'll include a follow-up discussion of some of the questions that we didn't get to talk about tonight, and we'll be asking our panellists for some of their thoughts on answers. We've also got some information up there, starting to collate a directory of producers locally to try and make it easier for locals to be able to purchase locally, either through the Port Macquarie Food Hub or the other avenues that are available. The other thing the other two things we want to do, one is that we're going to have up from tomorrow a list of actions that you could do this weekend.
You might not know that we've heard all about supporting local. The Wauchope Farmers Markets are on this Saturday. There's a farm tour out at Tom's Creek with Grow Sustainability this Sunday. Port Macquarie Food Hub is taking subscriptions. You could join the community garden, all these sorts of different ideas that you've heard talked about tonight, and more ideas that you've put to us. We want them on our list as well, and we want you bringing them to us on our social media as well. So, thank you for joining us this evening, and we hope that you go away with some ideas of vision and action